Hello, good evening everyone. At the outset, I would like to extend my heartiest welcome to all the participants who have joined in this live webcast. I'm Dr. Pavan Parashar. I'm a cornea consultant working at Amritsar, and I'm a professor at Shri Guru Ram Das Institute of Medical Science and Research, and I'm also director of Amritsar Eye Hospital. So I have been trained in cornea, external diseases and refractive surgery, as well as I have done a fellowship in ocular pathology from Jules Stein Eye Institute, Los Angeles. So I'll be briefly covering the topic importance of pathology in ophthalmology practice. I have no financial disclosure. So I'll start with the golden words by Sir William Osler. As is our pathology, so is our practice. So, ocular pathology, why is it important? In our Indian scenario, it is a relatively new subspecialty. It is not per se new, but it is kind of underdeveloped subspecialty, and most of our medical colleges and the private hospitals or most of our cities do not have a dedicated ocular pathologist. So you can just count on the fingers. Only some big tertiary institutes have this facility, and for general practitioner in the field or in smaller cities, tier 2 and 3, there are like unique problems. The general pathologists are usually not exposed to the ophthalmology slides, and ophthalmologists are not exposed to the pathological laboratories or specimens. Also, our Indian PG or resident curriculum is such that ophthalmic pathology is not taught as a discipline. Unlike in Western countries, for example, in USA, they have a dedicated rotation where the residents, it's mandatory that they have to go through a rotation in an ocular pathology lab for 6 to 8 weeks. And in India, there are very few ocular pathology laboratories. Now, what does an ocular pathologist do? So what ocular pathology basically comprises: histopathological examination of the specimen generated by the ophthalmologist from eyeball, orbit, skin, or adnexal structures. It is important because diagnosis may be important not just for the management of sight-threatening disorders, but quite often life-threatening diseases may also be involved. So having the accurate diagnosis makes a lot of difference, especially in conditions like vaginal granulomatosis and lymphomas and so many malignancies and stuff. So ocular pathology, basically the specimen, you may have a biopsy specimen generated from eyelid, cornea, conjunctiva, iris, retina, retinochoroidal tissue, any other orbital tissue, and also scrapings from cornea and conjunctiva. The type of specimens in an eye pathology lab would include corneal buttons from keratoplasty, lens after cataract surgery. Nowadays, it's not there because we do phacoemulsification most of the time. But in some conditions, you might want to send the lens to get a better picture of the pathogenesis, like in congenital cataracts. And iris tissue in trabeculectomy, vitreous specimen following vitrectomy, epiretinal membrane, retina or retinochoroidal tissue during retinal surgery, and eyeballs after enucleation or excentration. So in addition to the routine H&D staining, ocular pathologists may be involved in some special techniques like immunohistochemistry, flow cytometry, real-time PCR, proteomics, microarray, and electron microscopy. So, as ophthalmologist, what is the most critical part which a general ophthalmologist or anybody who is involved in the surgery or management of the patient, where you have surgery which will generate a pathology specimen, communication with the pathologist before, during, and after surgery is critical. And we should remember that final diagnosis is usually as a result of successful collaborative work between the clinician and the pathologist. So it is very important to provide relevant detailed history whenever a specimen is submitted to facilitate clinical pathological correlation. And for this, for routine cases, you can use relevant forms. and most of our specimens, they are sent in formalin. That's a routine that whenever you have a pterygium, you just throw it into formalin or any other tissue, and that's the normal way of doing it. But you should remember that in some cases, if the tissue is simply submitted in formalin, the opportunity for definitive diagnosis may be lost. So personal communication is very important, especially in cases where suspected malignancy or biopsy for a critical diagnosis, like in lymphoma, where fresh tissue is required to be sent for immunohistochemistry and molecular diagnostic studies, and glutaraldehyde fixed tissue, and meaning thereby tissue should be sent in glutaraldehyde if you need a electron microscopy for some reason to establish the diagnosis. The common stains used in IPATH laboratory include HND. That's almost universal. That's the basic stain. But in some condition, especially where you want to highlight the membranes like Descartes membrane or Bowman's layer, you use a PAS stain. Then to identify the microbes, there are stains like gram positive, gram negative, and for atypical mycobacteria, GIMSA for chlamydia and Jaden stain for mycobacteria. And these are also performed on tissue samples. It's a part of the infectious package. For fungus, GMS stain, and for Acanth amoeba, PAS stain is used, which shows a double wall cyst. There is another stain, calcofluor white, but you need a fluorescent microscope for that. But quite often you can recognize this cyst on PAS stain in the tissues. Then there are some special stains to highlight special substances, like in dystrophies and degeneration. Alcyon blue, it highlights mucopolysaccharide, and for corneal macular dystrophy. For band keratopathy, where calcium is deposited, it is highlighted by Algerin red or von Kossa stain. For granular dystrophy, mesenchychrome and hyaline stain, lattice dystrophy, amyloid, Congo red, and so on. And for iron, pearls prussian blue, it like in keratoconus or iron deposit, iron lines in the cornea, artisystole line, and so on, you have this bluish discoloration of the basal cells with prussian blue. To demonstrate lipid, you need like lipid stain, oil red O. And let's see some common pathologies which is common specimen which are submitted to ocular pathology lab. So pterygium, it is an elevated, we all know, triangular fibrovascular fold of conjunctiva, and so this is the clinical picture, and this will be histopathology. The characteristic histological signs include you have like marked irregular thickened epithelium, and the three cardinal features include elastotic degeneration, vascularization, and chronic inflammation in the substantia propria. So this is the normal conjunctiva, and this is the basophilic degeneration or elastoid degeneration. We call it elastoid because the material here it looks like elastin, but it is not degraded by elastases. So it is known as elastotic degeneration and not elastic degeneration, because it's not degraded by elastases. And quite often you have pigmented lesions of conjunctiva, which are taken out for cosmetic reasons or suspicion of a malignancy. I won't go into the details of the text so much. So you have a nevus here, and this is a histopathology. You have like nests of nevocytes which are collected in the substantia propria, and there are different types of nevus: intraepithelial, subepithelial, and compound nevus, where you have both the components. Then keratoconus, another very important you can say pathology, and quite often we do corneal transplant, either DALK or full thickness penetrating keratoplasty. And there is progressive ectasia or thinning and protrusion of the apical part of the cornea, or cone-like projection. So on histopathology, you have irregular thinning and thickening of the epithelium, and the hallmark of keratoconus is disruption of the Bowman's layer. That's the critical point, when you document progression of keratoconus, and in addition you have like some scarring in the superficial stroma, and obviously there would be some thinning at the marked thinning or depending upon the stage of the keratoconus in the apical part. Also, we all know there is a flasher ring in the cornea, like a ring shape where you have junction between the cone and the normal cornea, and the Prussian blue will highlight the iron pigment deposited in the basal epithelium. For PKP after high drops, you will have these ruptures in the desmoid membrane with scrolled edges, and again the loss of the normal architecture of the corneal stromal lamellae and scarring. Fuchs endothelial dystrophy, another common reason for corneal transplants, and we all know that it is associated with gradual decompensation of the cornea and bullous keratopathy. So what you see on histopathology is marked thickening of the Descemet's membrane, and you have this focal excrescences of the Descemet's membrane. This is known as guttae. So singular would be gutta, multiple guttae, and the condition is known as cornea guttata. And when you have decompensation of the cornea, that's a Fuchs endothelial dystrophy. And in our Indian scenario, we get most of these pseudophakic bullous keratopathy, complicated cataract surgery, and eventually cornea decompensate. And here you would have like marked attenuated endothelium and thickening of the corneal tissue. The bullous keratopathy, you have edema at within the epithelium and also subepithelium. Eventually there is blister formation or bulle formation. The epithelium detaches from the underlying Bowman's layer, and eventually there is you may see basement membrane duplication or subepithelial fibrosis if it is not treated in time by endothelial keratoplasty or penetrating keratoplasty. Chalazion, another very common pathology. It's a chronic lipogranulomatous inflammation, and you have a painless nodule in the eyelid as a result of blockage of the meibomian glands. And if the material is submitted, you have this empty spaces which signify that there was lipid, and which is absorbed during the processing of the tissue, and a lot of inflammation, chronic inflammation in the surrounding areas and these giant cells. So it is known as lipogranulomatous inflammation. Sometimes you may have tumors of the orbit or eyelid which can be submitted. Just to give a representative example, pleomorphic adenoma of the lacrimal gland, also known as mixed cell tumor. And here you should remember that prognosis is excellent if the tumor is excised completely, and if it is not completely excised, there may be a risk of seeding of the tumor and it may lead to recurrences. So just a representative example, this is a tumor S-shaped deformity of the eyelid. Usually these are the radiological pictures. You have soft tissue mass in the superotemporal orbit, and it is usually removed en bloc. It has a pseudo capsule, and on histopathology, you have both epithelial and mesenchymal elements, and that's why it is known as mixed cell tumor. And as I said, avoid biopsy to prevent seeding and recurrence. Then intraocular tumor, choroidal melanoma, most common primary malignant intraocular tumor in adults, and there is a long list of differential diagnoses. This I will skip, and just to show you the picture, so this is how eye would look like in cut section, and you have this color button appearance of the tumor, and retinal detachment of because it is tumor is in the subretinal space. And this is the slide of the same issue, eyeball. And here the pathologist will, in addition to describing the features of the tumor and cells, he has to comment on whether there is an extraocular extension, like in this case, through the vortex veins, and which is like the metastasis has occurred. And there are different types of classification depending upon the predominant cells, spindle cells, combination of spindle and epithelioid cells and so on. Epithelioid cells carry worse prognosis. Another picture which shows this heart-shaped tumor. Then another retinoblastoma, which is common primary malignancy in children, and I'm sure everybody knows it's a mutation of retinoblastoma gene. I won't go into the genetics much. On gross section, there is a cheesy white tumor arising from the retina tissue, and there are some characteristic features. One is flexner Wintersteiner rosettes, in which you have this eosinophilic tissue here, which has a lumen. That's flexner Wintersteiner rosettes. And then if you have this eosinophilic material without lumen, it is known as Homer Wright rosettes. And also these are florets. These florets are basically flower-like appearance, and florets, basically all these patterns signify aborted attempts at photoreceptor formation. In the retinoblastoma, there may be also areas of calcification and necrosis, which we usually decipher on ultrasound also. And rarely you may have specimens from other, these are life-threatening conditions. Giant cell arteritis, we all know it's a life-threatening condition, and quite often it's also visually significant. You have anterior ischemic optic neuropathy associated with giant cell arteritis. To establish the definitive diagnosis, a biopsy is taken from the temporal artery, and multiple sections are cut. There is a specific way of how these artery biopsies are processed. This is a normal artery, and this is occlusion of the lumen white in a case of giant cell arteritis. So there is a lot of inflammation and hyperplasia of tunica media, and demonstration of giant cells within the wall, that's the you can say hallmark or pathognomic of giant cell arteritis. And then you might have some infectious causes in which therapeutic penetrating retinoblastoma is done, and you might have to comment on the etiology. So you do infectious package. And in this particular case, there are multiple cysts scattered all over the stroma, and these double walled cysts are characteristic of acanthamoeba keratitis. So this was the basic general overview of what happens in a eye pathology lab. I'm sure the busy practices may be doing stuff at a very high level, but just at a very basic level. Now the second part, I'm going to show some unusual or some interesting cases of which I was directly a part, and these cases have been collected over the last few years, and just to demonstrate how pathology is important in management of the routine, otherwise routine cases in our day-to-day practice. So this 67-year-old female had undergone DSAC in her left eye. At 14 months post-op, a retrocorneal membrane was seen involving the temporal portion of the graft. So here you have a retrocorneal membrane in the temporal part, and associated with graft edema. So and Schenck-like image also showed thickened graft on the temporal region where the retrocorneal membrane was seen on slit lamp examination. So we went in and removed the graft and removed the surrounding Descemet's membrane also, and you could see that there is a multi-layered cells growing over the Descemet's membrane, both in the periphery and as well as in the on the undersurface of the graft. So multi-layered epithelium over the Descemet's membrane. Now to find out the origin, so the immunohistochemistry is done. Cytokeratin AE1 and AE3 stains were done, which showed that these are not multilayer endothelial cells, but epithelial cells. These are markers of the corneal epithelium. So this case was epithelial downgrowth after Descemet stripping automated endothelial keratoplasty, and it was published in Cornea, and it is one of the first report of this complication after DSAC. Another case, 47-year-old female presented with a mass in the right lacrimal sac region that was associated with intermittent watering, pain and itching, and showed delayed fluorescein clearance, meaning thereby with the signs and symptoms of nasolacrimal duct obstruction. CT scan showed soft tissue density in the lacrimal sac region. So this is the CT scan. So excisional biopsy was carried out, and on cut section there were white solid nodular mass was seen, pearly white in appearance. And on histopathology, H&E staining showed collagen bundles in a plywood pattern. And mesin trichrome stain, this is the blue is the collagen, and the red is the muscle fibers. And then various immuno stains were done, which were negative. And this was finally diagnosed as solitary sclerotic fibroma. And although mostly this entity occurs in dermis and is asymptomatic, but it can produce clinical manifestation by virtue of anatomical location, like in this case where it was pressing on the nasolacrimal sac and causing symptoms of nasolacrimal duct obstruction. And this case was published in Journal of Orbit, which is published out of Europe. Another interesting case, a 2.5 year old male was brought with a complaint of lack of movements in left eye, which was noticed at 5 months. Patient was from a poor socioeconomic status, and he presented to me here at Amritsar. And there were restriction of movements in all gazes and mild retraction of the lower lid margin. So this is the presenting picture. So you can see some exotropia, restriction of movement when the child sees the right, the eye does not move beyond the central axis, and some retraction of the lower lid. So MRI was done and showed it a soft tissue mass involving all the sinuses and pressing on the floor of the orbit and medial wall of the orbit, and which was probably leading to restriction of the movements as well as the retraction of the eyelids. So this case was managed by my ENT colleagues, who did a nasal endoscopy and then tried to do an initial biopsy through the endoscope, but it failed to establish the diagnosis, and eventually they did a complete surgical excision by lateral rhinotomy. So I won't go into the details, but basically this is the histopathology, spindle cells arranged in a storiform pattern and hyalinized trauma, and there are foci of cartilage and neural tissue interspersed all around. And we had to involve other pathologists also, because this was a very challenging case. And again, immunoreactive stains were done. And finally, this case was diagnosed as a nasal chondromesenchymal hamartoma, which is a rare benign tumor. And very few cases have been reported all over the world. And this was second case report of this entity from India. And it was kind of unusual, because here the patient presented to an ophthalmologist, myself, with restrictive ophthalmopathy. And again, this case was published in Orbit as a silent mass with ophthalmic presentation. Another case from ocular surface now, a 25-year-old female presented with gradually increasing mass in left eye for over 1 month, associated with redness, irritation and watering, no history of trauma, no other associated ocular and systemic illness. So visual acuity was normal, and you can see this gelatinous mass here, measuring 5 by 4 by 3 mm, and there was epithelial irregularity of the adjacent cornea. The mass appeared to be mobile over the underlying tissue, and other part of the examination were unremarkable. So I did an excisional biopsy under local peribulbar anesthesia. The mass was excised with 2 mm surrounding LD conjunctival tissue. It was not adherent to the underlying episcleral tissue, and it was followed with application of first cryo at the conjunctival margins, and then mitomycin C for 2 minutes. And this is a histopathology, and you have islands of squamous cells with keratin filled cyst in the substantia propria. And the cysts were lined by stratified squamous epithelium, and they were kind of characteristic because there was abrupt keratinization without any granular layer, which is persistent with trichilamellar keratinization. And despite being like a hyperproliferative, there were very signs of ATPA were minimal. And so in the post-operative period, there was an early pyogenic granuloma formation, which was treated with intensive topical steroids, and at 2 years follow-up, the patient had a well-healed conjunctiva with no evidence of recurrence. Now this girl is like 5 years old, and she comes regularly every 6 months or so, and there has been no recurrence. So this case was diagnosed as a proliferating pitchillamid cyst, which can present as a gradually progressing limbal mass. It is a benign condition that needs to be distinguished from malignant squamous cell carcinoma, which has a similar presentation but different prognosis. And management of cysts include wide excision with continued long-term surveillance. This case was presented in one of the American Society of Cataract and Refractive Surgery meetings at San Diego. Another case from cataract, a 45-year-old man presented with mass in left eye for, you can say, past couple of weeks. I had done a small incision cataract surgery around 2 months back. Post-operative period was otherwise uneventful. On examination, we have this like a nodular mass near the insertion of superior rectus muscle along with erythema of surrounding conjunctiva. Mass was otherwise non-tender and free from overlying conjunctiva. So we did literature, so I couldn't find much of any similar lesion, and only thing we found was inclusion cyst, which is known to be a complication after SACS. So presumptive diagnosis was made as inclusion cyst as per literature, and excision biopsy was planned. So the mass was excised under local anesthesia, and nothing unremarkable. Mass was noted to be relatively firm and adherent to the episcleral tissue. The overlying conjunctiva was preserved and sutured with Vicryl 60. On histopathology, it was a non-capsulated mass with chronic granulomatous inflammation, which means it was comprised of foreign body giant cell, epithelioid cell, plasma cells, and lymphocytes. And as we had predicted, there was no evidence of cyst. So it was a granuloma. So there was scattered foreign material in the mass which exhibited birefringence under the polarized light. So these are foreign body giant cells, and this material it exhibits refringence. It's like we look under polarized glasses and it kinds of lights up. So although the exact source of these particles we could not determine, but we speculate this could have either originated from the suture fragments from the superior rectus bridal suture or from the cotton fibers we use during the cataract surgery. And this case was also published as a subconjunctival granuloma after manual small incision cataract surgery. Another case, and this is the also I saw such a presentation for the first time, a 70-year-old male presented with complaint of whiteness in his right eye for 1 week along with mild irritation and redness. Loss of vision in right eye 20 years back, but he reported that the vision suddenly was lost, but due to poor, you know, economic background, he couldn't get a right treatment or surgery. No surgery was done, no systemic illness. So this is how we present it. You have right exotropia, no perception of light in the right eye. The IOP was 6 mm, I was soft, and it was 16 in left eye for comparison. And on slit lamp, dense hypopyon was seen involving more than one-third of the, almost half of the anterior chamber. And you could see floating, shining, yellowish-white crystal in the upper part. There was associated dense iris neovascularization and presence of white dense cataract. So this is like sparkling crystal. This is known as sparkling eye. And as the patient moved the eye, the crystals would just float in the aqueous chamber and give you like a sparkling, glittering and sparkling eye. The hypopyon was shifting in nature, that is, it changed position on lying to one side. Examination of other eye was unremarkable. This scan showed a cataract lens and a funnel shaped retinal detachment. So remember, the eye is PL negative, there's no vision. But patient is very concerned about the whiteness, and also I was concerned, being a cornea specialist also, so I was concerned about corneal decompensation and eventually developing intractable glaucoma. So again, I did a literature search, and we found that there are other similar cases have been reported with they call it crystalline pseudo hypopyon, and where they just aspirated these crystals from the anterior chamber. So after explaining the prognosis and everything, getting the informed consent from the patient, we went in and I tried to do an anterior chamber wash with this with Simcoe camera. And initially the crystals appear to come from the lens, and I kept on aspirating, but they would just not just not stop. They kept on coming, and for quite significant amount of time. And then in literature they say that maybe they originate from the lens, so a decision was made to remove the lens nucleus, do an ECC. But during the capsular axis, I realized there is a large zone of zonular dehiscence. So this was converted to ICCE, and the lens was removed. But again, we found that the crystals were actually coming from the vitreous cavity. So what actually happened was these crystals were there in the vitreous cavity, but due to whatever reason, there was zonular dehiscence, and for past couple of weeks, these crystals have found a way to come into the anterior chamber. Anyway, the AC was meticulously cleaned to remove the residual crystals, and this is at post of 1 week. We still have some a little bit of these crystals were still there, but for practical purposes, the patient had a good cosmetic outcome, and that the whiteness was gone. On the microscopic analysis, these aspirates showed transparent rhomboid crystal with notched border, suggestive of cholesterol crystals. So this condition is known as cholestyrolosis bulbi, and this may most likely the source is from the cholesterol in the RBC cells from old vitreous or subretinal hemorrhages, which finds a way into the anterior chamber. And the management is a dilemma because of the poor visual potential. You really don't want to operate on a PL negative eye. However, intervention may be necessary for cosmetic reasons as well as to prevent glaucoma or decompensation of the cornea. However, it's very critical to differentiate from other causes of pseudo hypopyon, as hypopyon of infectious origin is altogether a different entity, and it has a different management and prognosis. So this case was also published as a crystalline pseudo hypopyon. And then this is since I've been working for past several years at Amritsar, I found this unique corneal condition especially in the off-road agriculture workers here, where the patients have bilateral anterior stromal opacity in both eyes. So this is another case. It depends on, sometimes it's mild, sometimes it's very severe and visually significant, but it's not unusual. It's quite common in our part of the world. And we know that bilateral this condition, whether it can be dystrophy or degeneration, I spent a lot of time to establish the diagnosis. There's a whole long list of differential diagnoses, but unusual appearance of subepithelial, cloudy, ground glass appearance is unlike any of the pathologies in literature. And some of these patients had a lot of visual impairment, and quite significant of number of them had a coexisting cataract. So it becomes very important to explain the prognosis to the patient when you are doing a cataract surgery. Anyway, I managed to do a DLK on one of these patients, and you have these subtle granular deposits in the level of Bowman's layer and superficial stroma. It's quite unlike spheroidal degeneration, which we have globules of mauve colored substance deposited in the superficial stroma. And so then I consulted various people all over the in US and Europe, and we came to the final conclusion that this is a climatic proteoglycan stromal keratopathy. It was first reported in a paper by Waring et al. In American Journal of Ophthalmology. There's only one article. This is a series of these bilateral degeneration keratopathy Yeah, they reported in Saudi Arabia. And so this is a bilateral corneal degeneration with central horizontal round and oval gray ground glass haze confined to interpalpebral fissure, and they called it climatic proteoglycan glycan stromal keratopathy. And the histological appearance was quite similar to what they had reported. So so I presented this at one of the meetings of Asia Pacific Academy of Ophthalmologists, and we are in the process of putting up a series together. Another case, that was the lab slides, and sometimes it pays us to have a histology microscope in the clinic itself, and I'm going to share with you some of the atypical eyelid infestations or infections which are otherwise not diagnosed, or they are misdiagnosed, or they are underdiagnosed. So unless you have a microscope with yourself in the clinic, you may miss these entities. And even your microbiologist or general pathologist are unaware of these entities. So first case, a 25-year-old male presented with swelling in right lower lid and itching for 2 days. Other systemic examination was unremarkable. So you have this swelling here, looks like a sty. But if you look carefully, there is something like a blue, like a black object sitting here and matting of the eyelashes. So on higher magnification, you can see a lot of crusts here and an insect sitting here. So another picture. So I took it out, examined under the microscope, and there was a lot of debris, and it was like a cocoon. And you put like saline and dissolve this debris, and this is how it looks like. And you have like a black and orange part and legs, and so it's some kind of unusual insect. And I couldn't identify it. I sent it to entomology department at Punjabi University Patiala, and they identified it as a beetle, which is known as Petrus fusipes. It has black colored head and two abdominal segments. And eventually I found that it is very common in this part of the world, and especially in rice field. And this diagnosis was confirmed by genetic analysis also. And so this causes a condition is known as Petrus dermatitis, also known as blister beetle dermatitis. It's a kind of acute self-limiting contact dermatitis, also known as kissing dermatitis. You have a characteristic feature of linear vesicles, pustules, and kissing lesions, and caused by this Petrus, genus Petrus. So in this case, we prescribed lid hygiene, doxycycline, antibiotic eye drops, and ointments. These beetles, they breed in wet, rotting leaves and soil, and they are attracted to the light. So they tend to congregate around the light sources. So at the night time, they come into the human dwellings. And so this is where I work, and I was told by my students who have live in hostels here that it's actually quite common. They call it sprinter, and but we were not aware of this entity as ophthalmologist. So these beetles, they do not bite or sting, but their crushing against the skin can release a toxin known as piridine, which is a potent vesicant and leads to sudden onset of erythematous or bullous lesion on exposed part of the body, and inflammation of periorbital or ocular tissues that occurs by secondary transference of this piridine by the infected fingers. And then we put a series of 70-odd patients with different manifestations, and you have these symptoms here. I won't go into that detail, and periocular signs, but this is how it looks like. A lot of, you can say, skin excoriation, scab, necrosis, and erythema, swelling, and so on. And then ocular signs also, conjunctival congestion, epithelial erosion, and epithelial defects, and one of case had filamentary keratopathy also. And we published this in International Ophthalmology as ophthalmic manifestation of Petrus dermatitis. It's the first study of this entity from India in ophthalmology literature. It's a well-known entity in dermatology actually. Another case, 80-year-old female, farmer by occupation, watering from both eyes and itching over the eyelids. And I had done a cataract surgery 6 months back, and one of the routine follow-up visits, she presents like this. So you have something like tiny warts on the eyelids, and another this thing here. So on slit lamp examination, you have these wart-like excrescences in the eyelashes, and there were like a number of them. Another one here, and then there are small ones sitting over here. So one by one, I removed all of them and examined under the microscope. So it showed like these insects with the flat-bodied, brown flat-bodied insects with wide mouth and six legs. And I could not identify, and it was sent to a person who deals with these entities in GNDO, and this was identified. They couldn't identify here also. They sent it to one of the institutes in Chicago, where they identified it as a Rificifalus microplus. It's a tick. So treatment, manual removal, lid hygiene, antibiotic treatment, ointment at, for local application, avoid close contact with cattle, and oral doxycycline for any typhus or any other parasitic, these kind of infections. And this was published in Journal of Acarolosia. Acarolosia is a study of, it's a journal dedicated to study of ticks and mites. And I was told that the entomology people, they did not have any record of this tick in Punjab or North India. So it was kind of cool that it was first reported by an ophthalmologist. So another 38-year-old female came with swelling around the lid margin, both eyes, for 2 weeks. And if you look carefully, you have these like eggs in the base of the eyelashes. And another picture, and you had this kind of insect kind of moving within the eyelashes. So it took out, so we cleaned all these eggs and took a sample of a few of them, examined under the microscope, and this is the egg, and this is a crab louse as seen on under the microscope. So this condition is known as thyreosis pulpebrum and caused by crab louse or pubic louse. And treatment included mechanical removal with fine forceps, copious ointment at the bedtime to smother the lice. Also, it's very important to do examination of the family members, and as well as a dermatological consultation, because crab louse may be present, inhabiting the other parts of the body also. And follow up every 7 days for a month. In the literature, there are so many other treatments given. Treatment option for this condition, but antibiotic ointment works fine, and hygiene is very important. This was published. This video was published as a teaching case by American Academy of Ophthalmology. And finally, I'll describe another entity of three patients together. So this is a 45-year-old male, complains of ocular surface symptoms like itching and watering for 2 months, but otherwise seemingly otherwise normal eyes. Same way, another patient with some itching and redness and sometimes non-specific symptom, female, swelling around the lid margin and stuff. So here, if you look carefully at the base of the eyelashes, they look like squamous blepharitis, and it's easy to dismiss these cases and treat as squamous blepharitis with lid hygiene only. But sometimes you have like focal areas of lash loss or medrosis here, and then lash loss and misdirected cilia. Another cylindrical dandruff. And if you epilate these eyelashes and look under the microscope, you see these characteristic bugs in very close relation to the hair follicle. And they have these claws like thing here. Another picture. And if you put saline on under the cover slip, these tend to float away. So another picture. And they have these claws and a body. And I had a video, but the video is not playing for some reason. So this condition is known as Demodex blepharitis and usually caused by two mites in humans, Demodex folliculorum and Demodex brevis. Pathogenesis include microabrasion by the claws, as these mites, they move and these claws produce injury in the hair follicle. So that's why they have a lot of keratin formation and cylindrical dandruff formation, which is characteristic clinical signs. There is direct damage by the mites by just their sheer volume, and the mites may also act as vector for bacteria. There is a bacteria especially which is known to in its gut, Bacillus oleroneus. It shares a symbiotic relationship, and this has been demonstrated to be one of the etiopathogenic causes of rosacea. That's why rosacea people have a lot of Demodex. And this mite is peculiar. It does not have an excretory system. So it keeps on ingesting sebum and then eventually it dies. And when it dies, its debris elicits the inflammatory response leading to symptoms of ocular discomfort and blepharitis. And we probably presented this series where we reported that with age and with severity of symptoms and male, it's more common. And this was presented in All India Ophthalmology Society. Treatment includes lid hygiene, topical ointment for local application. Specific treatments include tea tree oil scrubs, which are now available in India. And also another treatment is oral ivermectin 12 mg one stat, followed by another 12 mg as 2 weeks. And this was published as proceedings, and it was adjudged as the best paper in one of the All India conferences. To conclude, there is need for ophthalmologists to have high index of suspicion, and a microscopic examination of suspicious lesions should always be carried out, and it is critical in establishing the correct diagnosis. And the need for close collaboration with the pathologist and microbiologist cannot be overemphasized. And to conclude, again with the golden words, as is our pathology, so is our practice. Thank you very much for your attention, and now I will try to see if I can answer your questions. How to differentiate between herpes simplex vesicles and vesicles of insect dermatitis? Not always easy to differentiate between the two, these lesions, they are like characteristic in the differential diagnosis would be herpes zoster. In herpes zoster, the lesions, they respect the midline. So you would have only on the one side of the forehead, and then it will be involving only the one dermatome. I cannot make it enlarge it. Just a second. All right, and so the pedras dermatitis, the characteristic history is the patient most likely during the night time they would crush this insect whenever it is kind of crawling over the body, and then they touch their face, so it will respect it will the lesions would be in a linear distribution, and with these lesions you have more of a what you call burning sensation. In Punjabi here we say that bahut zyada saad penda, it's like a lot of burning sensation. Herpes lesions are more painful, and like zoster we have like prodrome, and then these vesicles they respect the midline, and most of these pedras lesions they heal without scarring. It's the chemical is it produces it's like a chemical injury, but the lesions are not very, the burns are not very deep, and quite often even if it involves a cornea, it heals without any scarring. So that was one question, and another question was incidence of cholestyrosis bulbi. I really don't know. It's, I think it's very rare, and most likely these are like complex retina cases where you have a lot of vitreous hemorrhage and stuff. But I would have seen like over the last 10 years, like 2 cases. And then that was from Sunil Pantiala. Dr. Arpan Gandhi, thank you, Dr. Gandhi. Dr. Arpan Gandhi is a renowned ocular pathologist at Shroff Hospital in Delhi. He says, blood samples of photogenic study and research can be sent for storing in biorepository at minus 10 degrees centigrade freezer. The case series is extended. Yes, I think as I said, that in India we do not really have a lot of emphasis on ocular pathology, probably because the pathologists, they think that they are not going to make a lot of money because ophthalmologists generate very few specimens. And so it would be great to have, you know, labs like yours where you have like dedicated pathology service. For myself, I am trained to some extent in pathology, but I do not really practice pathology to a large extent. I just, you know, kind of dwell into it for my cases in particular. But thank you very much for your comment. And, she got Gunit Gaur, she got excision under peribulbar. Yes, ma'am. She got under peribulbar anesthesia, the limbal nodule. I think that's what you are referring to. Yes, that was excised at that. Dr. Rao was not happy with the transmission quality. I apologize for the same. And another comment, anonymous, extremely important. I somehow cannot get this box open. Extremely important to gross the specimen properly, margin orientation should be perfect, and trained action. Yes, Dr. Gandhi, thank you for your comment. It's very important, as I emphasized. You will lose a lot of information if you do not send, if you do not communicate with your pathologist, you do not send the detailed history of the patient, and then you just throw the specimen in the formalin chamber. That would be lead to the pathologist will have a lot of problems, because quite often we do have like the reports coming from pathology where they will just write like collagen tissue and with some inflammation, and that really serves no purpose, and that way they gave a used a technical term, but it doesn't serve any useful purpose for the clinician. And I think that should be all. So I think that should be all. I think I is there a record, please? Thank you. Okay. I think one of the participants wants to know that if there is any recording of this presentation. I hope the Lupin people kind of looks into it. What is the ideal way to deal with lacrimal mass? There are like lacrimal mass, you're referring to lacrimal gland or lacrimal sac. I think it depends. There are when you are suspecting a pleomorphic adenoma, there are like characteristic radiological features. So your oculoplastic or orbital surgeon will and the radiologist to kind of make a decision. And for pleomorphic adenoma, it's advisable you remove it en bloc. And if you are referring to the lacrimal sac mass, then it's an altogether different entity. It really depends whether patient needs a decryo cystectomy or that kind of stuff. But if you are suspecting any malignancy, you have to remove it and then do a histopathological examination. Pedras lesions are to be treated by dermatologist bias. Very important question. Thank you, Dr. Nisha, for asking it. Pedras dermatitis or vitreous dermatitis is a common entity in dermatology literature. They treat it. But when you have a lesion coming in the eye or patient has associated ocular symptoms, the patient would present to the ophthalmologist. So what we do here, because we had a dermatologist on this study, so we recognize this entity, but we always take a dermatology consult for lesions, because almost like 1/4 of 25 to 30% of these patients would have lesions on other part of the body. So if the lesions are in the eyelid and ocular surface, then obviously we will treat it, but for other parts there it will be by the dermatologist. It's I think it's a teamwork. So thank you for your question. Dr. Pratibha, please send video recording. I'll request Lupin people to kind of look into the participants who want the recording. Dr. Ahmed Khalif, thanks really for the PPT. That was indeed fruitful. Thank you, Dr. Ahmed. Thank you for the kind remarks. That's like very encouraging. And thank you. Thank you so much. You're very kind. Dr. Arpan Gandhi, good job, Dr. Prasher. Pleasure to hear you talk and awesome publication. Thank you, Dr. Gandhi. I take it as a huge compliment coming from somebody like you. Thank you so much to be one of the listeners, and hopefully we can put up a better program, both from clinical and pathology perspective for our listeners in future.